Good morning, Emmanuel Assembly. How's everyone doing today? We're so very glad to have you here today. It's going to be an awesome day together in the house of the Lord. Jesus is amazing, is he not? Amen. Well, I first want to kind of just start off and say thank you to everybody who helped yesterday. I think we easily served 150 probably plus meals. Thank you very much for your help. I know the community appreciated it. We had a line going all the way around the room. It was great. So if you're interested in helping with any of our community meals, please become a part of that. It's been a wonderful experience to bless the community and engage with people. It's wonderful. If you have your bulletins with you today, let's go over a few of our announcements today so you have that all with you and ready to go. Today we don't have our normal Sunday afternoon programming because we have a special guest with us today. My pastor, Pastor Dan, is here and he's going to be sharing the word with us today, and so we're going to be spending the afternoon with him, and so we're just very appreciative of having him and his time and his attention here today. It's a wonderful thing. We also are resuming our normal midweek programming this week, so we have our groups that are meeting throughout the week, and if you are not a part of our Wednesday night, I encourage you to come because we're starting a new book right now called Pilgrim's Progress. If you've never read it, it's a wonderful work and a lot of great, wonderful life lessons to learn from it. I have books available and reading plans, so see me if you're interested and you don't have one. We would love for you to come out on Wednesday night and be a part of that. We also have our time of worship and prayer on Thursday night. Encourage you very strongly to become a part of that. It's a great time together in the Lord and just getting our hearts and minds even ready for the weekend and just having this time together where we can share a little bit in the Word, but then we get into prayer and worship. It's been a wonderful time. We're updating our fellowship directory, so if any of you need new information, maybe you want to update a picture, maybe you don't want that picture updated, you know, all of that detail is in the back there. This Friday as well, ladies, we're doing a game night for the ladies. They just had a wonderful time at the Breathe Conference. I know many of you went to that. But there's also another chance this Friday night to get together, just have some social fun time and enjoy each other's company. Next Sunday, we're having water baptism and got some good things planned for that. But if you have never been baptized and you would like to take that step and kind of go to that next step with the Lord in your relationship and publicly acknowledge your faith in Jesus Christ, sign up for that. We would love for you to be a part of that. We can quickly add you in, and nothing too amazing other than the fact you will get a little wet. I believe Jesus wants to do a wonderful work in our lives as we grow and as we mature in him, and so I'm very excited for next week and all of that holds in store. There's more things there in the back that you can kind of check out and look at on your own time. If you have questions about anything, please see me, see one of our board members. We would love to answer any questions you might have. But with all of the commercials out of the way, why don't we stand? Because we've come together to worship the Lord, to praise Jesus' name, which is why we are here. So let's get our hearts and minds ready for some worship today and spend some time with loving on Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Oh, Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence, which is already here. We thank you, Lord, that you're here and you're with us. Whether we feel you or not, you are here. So today, Heavenly Father, some of us has come in this weekend with maybe a time of uplifting that we've just had maybe recently in the Word or in prayer or spending time with other believers. Maybe we're coming in today feeling alone. Maybe we're coming in today feeling a little beat down by what's happened this last week. Whatever state that we come in, Lord, we get this time right now, Jesus, to put all those things aside, to cast all of our cares upon you because you care for us, and to set those things aside and rejoice in the Lord. Whether times are good, whether times are bad, we rejoice in the Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you. We dedicate this time to you. You are awesome. You are awesome, Jesus, and we love you with all of our hearts. So, Lord, I just pray today, Heavenly Father, as we sing and as we praise, that you are lifted up and that you come and dwell with us. And as we draw near to you, you draw near to us. We need you today, Jesus. We love you so much, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have come.
and gathered in his name to worship.
Give the Lord some praise today. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Search us and know us, God. Right now, Heavenly Father, look through our hearts, the inventory of our lives. Search us and see if there's anything in us, Lord, that is displeasing to you, that's wicked in us, God. Cleanse us and make us clean, Jesus. We want to get our hearts and minds right now ready to receive communion. Instructed in 1 Corinthians 11 by the Apostle Paul to examine ourselves. It's not to condemn, but Jesus died to set us free from our sin. So if there's any sin remaining, a beautiful promise. We confess our sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So right now, just have that secret time with the Lord. Just humble yourself beneath the mighty hand of God right now here in his presence. Oh, Jesus, make me clean. I'm not going to touch and take communion in an unworthy manner. I'm not going to take lightly the great sacrifice that you paid on the cross for my sin. Oh, Lord Jesus, cleanse me now and make me clean. My hope is in you. We've just been singing about the blood. There's nothing stronger than the blood of Jesus Christ. There's no sin that's deeper than the reach of his grace. Right now, he can forgive you. He can set you free. Just give that to the Lord right now. It doesn't have to just be another time where we drink some juice and eat a cracker. It's so much more than that. It's spiritually significant. Oh, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. You are worthy. We appreciate what you've done for us. I'm going to sing through this again. And while I'm singing, just come up here to the front. Go ahead and take one of the elements and bring them back to your seat. And we'll take it together here in a moment once everybody's received. Go ahead and start coming. Oh, there is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. Of the blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by Father, through the blood, through the blood. Oh, there is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood, of the blood. Oh, it calls to sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood. It has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus. You have saved my life. He brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Oh, he brought us from the darkness into glory. Everybody had a chance to receive. We want to make sure we wait for everyone. I'm not impatient. Well, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. The night that he knew it was all going to go wrong. Gave thanks to God for it. Said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it. Oh, Lord Jesus, we remember your body today, Lord. You lived a real life. You weren't just a spiritual being or an idea or a myth or a legend. You lived a real life. You went through real pain. You were touched with the feelings of our infirmities. You were tempted in every way like we were, yet without sin. And you sacrificed your real life on a real cross for our real problem. We were sinners in need of a Savior. Thank you, Jesus, so much for what you've done for us. Thank you for giving your life, for enduring all of that, for the joy that was set before you. I'm amazed by what you've done for me, Jesus. So we remember what you've done and the toll that it took on you. That was the depth of our sin. Thank you, Jesus. Let's partake together. The same way after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new agreement between God and his people, an agreement that's been confirmed by my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you announce the Lord's death until he comes again." Thank you, Jesus, for the shed blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. How could our sins be removed from us unless the price had been paid? And you paid that price, Jesus. You shed your blood. And now, the Spirit of the living God that raised Jesus Christ from the dead quickens us. So now we are no longer defined by sin and corruption, destruction and death, but now we can be made alive to God through Christ Jesus. The same blood that carries oxygen through our veins and spiritually carries the wind of the Holy Spirit through our very being. It's in him we live and move and breathe and have our very being. So, Lord, we praise you today. Remember that you did not just stay dead. You didn't just pay the price. That would have been enough, but you rose from the dead and conquered death, hell, and the grave. And so we rejoice today that your promise is you're coming again. And we have hope today because of the blood of Jesus Christ. So, Lord, we thank you for your blood. We do not take it insignificantly. We do not take it for granted. We know what it cost you, and we appreciate what it is doing and what it has done, and will continue to do until the day that we see Jesus face to face. So, Lord, sanctify us, purify us, make us clean, and make us alive to God. In Jesus' name, hallelujah, amen. Let's take it together. Praise you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, there is nothing stronger. Wonder-working power of the blood. Of the blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood.
Disconnected.
Oh, Lord Jesus. We love you so much today. We need you so much today. Lord, there are so many things right now. Our country needs you. Our state needs you. Our town needs you. This world needs you. Our families need you. Our school desperately needs you. Our businesses, our leaders need you, Jesus. Help us be the love of Jesus Christ. Help us be your love, your hands, your feet extended to this world. Stir the change in us, God, that the world needs. Move us to deeper places of love and connection with you and your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray for protection over our community. I just heard a story this morning how a local school bus was vandalized, and our own van here at the church had been vandalized earlier this year. People are desperate, and they do desperate things when they're on drugs and alcohol and their lives are wrecked, and they just need hope, and they're searching for hope and all this stuff. And that isn't where hope is found. Hope is found in you, Jesus. Our community needs you. Our lives need you. Our homes need you. Every part of us. Our young people desperately need you in a world that's going to attack them for being passionate about God. And peers that are going to attack them for being passionate about God. Oh, Lord, there's people in our body right now that need healing. We pray for Phil right now who's in the hospital. Jesus, continue to heal his back. Provide for all of his needs, Lord. Help him with the renovations that need to be done at his home and just all these things, Lord. He needs your help, Lord. We pray for Gayanne this morning, God, that you continue to heal her from the cancer. She just finished certain treatments, God. We believe that it is healed in Jesus' name. It goes no further in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for those who can't make it here today. We remember Bertha. We remember Debbie. We just remember so many people, Lord, that just can't make it because they just can't. And I just pray that you comfort them and give them grace and peace, Lord. Strengthen Ron today, Lord. Just pray for him as well, Jesus. You're the glory and the lifter of his head. And the strong arm of your grace will never leave him or forsake him, Jesus. Oh, Heavenly Father, these things and a host of other things, Lord, we just dedicate to you. We pray, Lord, that you bless us. We pray for your healing. We pray for your anointing. We pray for the privilege of being used. I pray, Heavenly Father, as well, for our district pastor, Pastor Dan. I pray, Lord, that you anoint him. You fill him with your Holy Spirit. Give him your grace. As he speaks the word to us today, may we receive it. May you accomplish exactly what you want done in our lives. Make us receptive and humble to receive. We ask your blessing over all of this today in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Pastor Dan, would you come?
Well, good morning, church. You're looking good. Yeah, you're smiling. And thank you, worship team, by the way. Beautiful, beautiful sense of the presence of the Lord here today. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. It's always good to come and to share the word with you. And I'm excited to be here once again. And I'm excited that you're here because you heard that I was coming. And so you showed up anyway. I mean, now, I usually tell you something a little comical before I start, but I don't remember what I've used in the past. So, anyway, I've been thinking a lot about retirement these days, you know, and it reminded me of a little story. There was a gentleman who retired, and he became a Walmart greeter. And he was doing a great job. You know, the staff loved him, and the customers who came in loved him, you know, and such. But he had one issue, and the manager had to talk to him a little bit, and he said, you know, you're really doing a great job, and staff loves you, customers love you, but you have a hard time getting here on time. He said, so what did your, you know, in your previous employment, what did they say to you if you were late? He said, well, they would say, good morning, Admiral. Would you like your coffee now or later? Oh, my. Oh, well. Well, you ready to get into the Word a little today? Ephesians chapter 2 for our consideration this morning. Ephesians chapter 2, we're going to look at the first couple of verses there. I'll read my text and then we'll pray. I'll have a little introduction. And then we'll try to unpack this text a little bit for you this morning. Is that all right? All right. Ephesians chapter 2, first 10 verses, he says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you formerly walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too also formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging in the desires of our flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. He raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are created, or we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. Lord, thank you for your word. Your word is truly a lamp and a light. Lord, as the psalmist declared, we want to hide your word in our hearts, that we may truly not sin against you, that we may be transformed into the image of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Today, the title of my message is Show Me Your ID. Show me your ID. Angela and I travel a bit by virtue of the reality of our position. And every time I go to a hotel, even if I'd been there many times before, what is the one question that the young lady or the young man behind the desk is going to ask me? They're going to ask me for my ID. Right? So I have to pull out my license and I have to show them and so on. And so who we are seems to matter for some reason. It's interesting that in the world today, identity is something that is being confused, and tremendously so. Tremendously so. There was a German Jewish psychologist by the name of Erich Erikson. And he's the fellow who coined the term identity crisis. How many of you ever heard that term, identity crisis, before? Yeah, he's the fellow who did it back in the 1940s. But I would propose to you that this issue of identity and who we are goes all the way back to the point of the beginning of all things in Genesis. Because in truth, that's exactly what happened to Adam and Eve. They traded their true identity for a false one. They were created as the children of God, born of God, created of God, breathed in of God, and what they did was they decided to believe a lie, and they took the identity that the enemy sold them. Didn't stop there. And as we take a quick scan through Scripture, we're going to see that there was an issue even with Abraham. Abram became Abraham. Abram, he had a need to change his identity. Jacob became Israel. He had a change of identity. What is interesting to note is that their identity changed in relationship to their connection to God. And that's where we're going with this today. Your true identity is not found in the world. It's not found in your career. It's not found in your family. It's not found in your ethnicity. It's not found in your sexuality. It is found in Christ. And the more we understand that, the more our revelation of who Jesus is, then the greater our understanding of who we are. Let's look at Moses for a minute. If anybody was a psychological mess, it was Moses. Right? I mean, sent off in the river. As a very young child, sent off in the river, then raised by people who were not his family, right? Then later, after he chose to identify, that's a term people use today, isn't it? Right, I can identify. That's what the world teaches you. The world teaches you you can identify as anything you want. You can be anything. That's the world's message, right? Be anything you want. I want to be a center for the Celtics. What do you think? Oh, go for it, Pastor. Go for it, man. Come on. The world is silly when they say things like that to our young people. You can't be anything you want, and you certainly cannot become a different gender. Do you know that at least one list, there are 81 different genders? Wow. Talk about confusion. Talk about chaos. Talk about a world that doesn't know anything about what's going on because they were disconnected from their true identity, which is in Christ. So Moses is sent off. He chooses to identify with the Hebrews, right? Raised as an Egyptian, but then also raised by his mother. And then finally he decides. He's making a decision. I am going to be a Hebrew. So what does he do? He kills an Egyptian slave master. People who don't know who they are do stupid things. Then what does he do? He finds out that not only is he rejected by the Egyptians, but now he's rejected by the Hebrews too, and he runs. People who don't know who they are run. They go places. They're discontent. They don't know where life is, and they're always looking for something else, something else, something else, trying to find something else. Maybe this will work for me. Maybe this will work for me. Maybe that. It's what Moses ended up doing. But then you know some more of the story. Moses, at what should have been the peak of his life, is basically an absolute nothing. He's at the lowest place a person could be on the economic totem pole. He's a shepherd out there. And then he sees a burning bush. Now, I'm sure he thinks, uh-oh, because that bush is talking to him. And I'm sure he thinks, oh, geez, now I'm really nuts. And God speaks to him and gives him a job, gives him a responsibility. And it's interesting to note what Moses' response to God is. He says, who am I? Who am I? Now, he does add that I should go to Pharaoh, but the question is, who am I? And interestingly enough, God didn't give Moses the speech. The speech I referred to a moment ago, you know, that just reach down deep inside. You can be anything you want. You've got it. You're enough. God didn't give him the speech. God said this, I am who I am. He didn't answer his question. Moses didn't ask, who are you? He asked, who am I? And God said, who you are is not the issue. The issue is, who am I? Because your connection to me is what makes you something. And that's the issue. That's the absolute issue, our connection to Jesus. But you know what? Let's go up a little farther, because this actually mattered to Jesus. In the baptism, you remember the baptism of Jesus? Comes up out of the water, and what does he hear the Father say? Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. What happens immediately after the baptism? Jesus goes into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And what question does the devil ask him? If you are the Son of God, what did he just hear? What did he just hear the Father say? You are my Son. But the devil brings question to his identity. Jesus didn't fall for the same trap that Adam and Eve fell for. He says, man shall not live by bread alone. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. Satan, you shall worship. Basically, he said, you'll worship me because I know who I am. What Jesus said. But it didn't stop there, because they ended up, that is Jesus and the disciples, they were at a place called Caesarea Philippi. Very interesting place. It was a place of pagan temples, especially to the god Pan. And Jesus was there, and there were these buildings, and people would do sacrifices and stuff. It was a highly pagan Gentile area, Caesarea Philippi. And Jesus asked the disciples a question. You remember that? He says, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And then Peter says, well, or, you know, Elijah, one of the prophets, But then he says, who do you say that I am? Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. You remember that? Again, Jesus' response to him was interesting. Jesus said, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Now, let me ask you a question. Who was probably the greatest teacher of human beings that ever walked the planet? We would say Jesus. But Jesus said, Peter, I didn't teach you this. He was standing there, how? In flesh and blood, right? He said, Peter, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father. You see, who we are in Christ is spiritually discerned. We cannot understand it from a human perspective. It is something that is spiritually understood and spiritually discerned that the Father reveals to us. Who are you? It matters. It matters. But it even matters to believers who don't understand well who they are. Because even though you are in Christ, there needs to be additional understanding and revelation. I was listening to an interview, happened to be, by the way, Dr. Phil. I don't know if anybody ever heard of Dr. Phil. He said he frequently asks a question to people. And he asks them, who are you, but do not tell me what you do for a living? Identify yourself, but don't identify yourself by your occupation. He says, almost all the time, people are stumped by that question. Who am I? Even believers have a hard time with that. Well, I'm a carpenter. I'm an electrician. No, that's not who you are. I'm a mother. No, that's not who you are. That's a role you play right now. How many of you know that those roles change? So who are you? I've gone through many roles in my life, but that doesn't tell me who I am. So who are you? In fact, interestingly enough, the first three chapters of Ephesians deal with this very topic of who we are in Christ. I'm just going to hit a little piece of it today. Just a little piece of it today. Is that slide, you got that slide up there, Eric, by any chance? This is who we were. This represents that. See those six areas? Authority, influence, sexuality, feelings, emotion, creativity, intellect, language, communication, will or choice. And what's in the center? Self. That's what we were. Those areas represent, those six areas represent the fact that we were created in God's image. God is authority and influence. God has created sexuality. God has feelings and emotions. God has creativity and intellect. God is a communicating person. God has will and choice. And when we were created in his image, those are things he gave us. However, because of sin, all have sinned, the image of who God is in us has been distorted, broken, wounded, all of those things. And all of those things, in some way or another, even when we come to Christ, need healing. That's a good place to say amen. What about feelings and emotion? Anybody ever ruled by your emotions? Oh, Pastor, you quit preaching and gone to meddling now. How about will or choice? You ever made choices based on things other than your submission to God? How about language and communication? You ever talk to anybody disrespectfully? You ever spout off when you shouldn't and then blame it on your Irish or your Italian? How about sexuality? All of these things are broken. And God desires for us to be made whole. But it starts with Jesus becoming the center. Just go to that other slide now, guys. It starts with Christ at the center. And you can just leave that there. And now I want to go to the text and just unpack it a little bit. All right? We're going to talk about three things. One, who you were. One, who you are. Number three, who you are becoming. Who you are becoming. The text says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That word dead matters. Because there are two kinds of death in the Bible. There's physical death and spiritual death. And both of them mean the same thing in this sense. They mean separation. In spiritual death, I am separated from God. In physical death, my internal person, my spirit, my soul is separated from my body. But it means separation. It does not mean unconsciousness. Nor does it mean the inability to respond. It means separation. When Adam sinned, he immediately died because he was separated from God, but he didn't physically die immediately. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. And it says, in which you formerly walked. We were literally the walking dead. Say, I used to be a zombie. That's the walking dead. That's exactly what this is. We were the walking dead. Destructive, hurtful, a ruination in every respect. That's what we were. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. And it says, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world. You were on a path, a course that the enemy designed for you. That was, you were walking in it. You were walking in that course. According to the course of the world. What is the world? Let me condense that into this. In terms of relationships, the world is use, manipulation, exploitation, dominance, and control. That's how I lived. Use, exploitation, dominance, control. That's what I wanted and that's what I needed. The trouble is, a lot of us haven't given up all of that. Oh, there you go again, Pastor. But what is the course of the kingdom? love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. What are those? The fruit of the Spirit. You're dead in your trespasses and sins according to the course of this world. And then it says, according to the prince of the power of the air, who is the purveyor of this course, who makes this course, it's the enemy. He says, according to the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. I am sure that you despair of the moral direction that our culture is going, as well as I do. But listen, I don't want you to get angry at those who are caught up in the course of this world. I want you to get angry at the one who is at the root of it all. You come against the enemy. Our struggle, Paul says, is not with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the world forces of this darkness. According to the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. And if you don't think that there is a spirit behind all of these things, even in our legislation and in our schools and what the kids are being taught and all of this stuff, it's a spirit that's behind that. And it's the spirit of the world. It's the spirit of the enemy that is working in the sons of disobedience. But wait a minute. Let's not sit ourselves up so self-righteously right now, because it says, among them, we too all formerly lived. There was a time all of us were that place. And it says, lived in the lusts of our flesh. Now that word lust, we think of it usually in terms of sexuality, but it means any inordinate desire. It includes sexuality, but it anything, power, prestige, security, you name it, lust for the flesh, indulging in the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And look at this. It says, and we're by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. That's a nasty word. Just saying the word wrath doesn't sound like a nice word, does it? But some people get the idea that God is mad at people, and that God is up there in heaven just waiting with his giant divine fly swatter ready to whap people. And no. This doesn't really speak to that kind of an attitude at all. What wrath really is the inevitable consequence of walking the course of this world. If I jump off the roof, I will fall. And if I jump off the roof and nothing happens to me, okay. But what if I continue to jump off the roof? Because eventually, what's going to happen? Something is going to go. Anything could happen, right? Now, I love this illustration, so I've used it before. How many of you have ever tried to tighten or loosen a screw with a butter knife? Okay, now, you can get away with it sometimes, can't you? But eventually, what will happen? You'll either strip the screw or you'll ruin the knife, one or the other, right? Because butter knives are for butter, right? And screwdrivers are for screws. When we try to do things our own way and circumvent what God has done, eventually it goes bad for us. Among them we too also lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging in the desires of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest." I love the next two words. What are the next two words in the text? But God. But God. Being rich in mercy. How many of you here today are glad for the mercy of God? We celebrated that mercy when we shared communion together this morning. We didn't deserve what Jesus did on Calvary's cross. He showed us mercy. He loved us enough to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. But God, being rich in mercy. And why was he rich in mercy? Because of the great love with which he loved us. Mercy and love. And it says, even when we were dead, even when we were separated in our transgressions, it says, he made us alive. I couldn't enliven myself. He made us alive. He called us forth out of the tomb that we were in. He stood in front of the tomb we were in and called us by name and said, "Come out." And like Lazarus, still wrapped in our stuff, still, we came out. And the term was, loose him and let him go. How many of you would admit to me that even though we're in Christ, there may still be some grave clothes that need to come off? There just may be some stuff in my heart that needs to be taken away. Amen? Oh, yeah. You see, if any man be in Christ, he is a... But there's also this transformation piece. That we are being transformed by the renewing of our mind. Even though he made us alive, we were dead, he made us alive. But there is more. He made us alive together with Christ by grace. What is grace? I know the common definition is unmerited favor, and which is fine, but I like this one better. Grace is God's transformational power to take me from where I am to where he desires for me to go. Grace is the power of the Holy Spirit to turn me into who I need to be in Christ. Grace is conforming me to the image of Christ. That's what grace is. That's what grace does. For by grace you have been saved. And then it says, he raised us up with him and seated us with him. I love that. We still use that term today, seated, like it's used here. For example, if a politician or some other political person is put into office, they're said to be seated, right? When the judge comes in, he's got his robe on, and he does what to himself? He seats himself, and then things can proceed. You have been seated with Christ in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You are in a position of power and authority in Christ. So who are you? I'm alive, together with Christ. Who are you? I am seated in the heavenly places in Christ. You have an answer now. No, I'm not just a mother or just a father or just whatever occupation or just, no. I am alive in Christ. I am seated in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I am a new creation created in Christ Jesus. That's who you are. You say, Pastor Dan, that, I get the words, but I don't know that it's a reality yet. Yes, that's the point. Because the more we know Jesus, the more of a reality we will begin to understand. A couple of illustrations. We are in Christ. So if I had a bucket up here and I put a ball in it, I can say that the ball is in the bucket. And wherever the bucket goes, the ball goes. True or false? Okay. I could even maybe swing that bucket and the ball will stay in there. Okay? So that's where we're in. But there's another way to think of it. When I married my wife, I could say that I am in marriage. Does that make sense? Okay. Because that changes me. I now have things I didn't have. And now I can do things I couldn't do, and I can't do some things that I maybe. I have in-laws. That may or may not be a good thing. Everything she has is mine. Everything I have is hers. And I am different. When I fill out a form, I no longer check the single box. I check the married box. However, I could actually be married, but not really that well connected to my spouse. True or false? You see, there are a lot of people who have been married to Jesus, but they still want to live single. It's time for us to connect. You are in Christ. Seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ, so that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. This is a very, very powerful verse. Your life, as you become what God desires for you to be, is a testimony of what God can do. Therefore, you should be, in every respect, an evidence of the reality of God. You are a testimony. You are a witness. You are someone looks at and says, wow, God must be alive because this person is not who they used to be. They've changed. And it's done by grace. God does it in us. Now, the inverse is also true, unfortunately. That is, I can name the name of Christ, and some may point to me and say, if that's a Christian, I don't know that I want that. That happened. I could tell you a story. My father, who wasn't a believer, I don't know what the reasons behind that was, but nonetheless, I remember him coming home from work one day. He worked with a fellow who happened to attend the church, and we attended. My father didn't attend church. And I remember him saying to my mother, "If that guy goes to your church, it's all the more reason I'll never step foot in that door." Now, I don't know what happened. I was just a little boy, but I remember it like it was yesterday. Are we being the testimony? Now, how many of you can say, honestly, Pastor Dan, God has changed my life tremendously? How many of you can say it? Absolutely. That is a testimony. But how many of you would also admit to say, you know, there's more to go? There's more to go. There's more to go. Yeah. And that ongoing testimony is what God wants, so that in the ages to come, he may show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. You are obligated in relationship to those around you to be becoming more and more and more like Jesus. Wow. How many of you say, Pastor Dan, that's tough? Now, let me stop you for a minute, because you will never do it by self-discipline. Okay, that's it. All right, I will never do whatever again. Yeah, right. You know that's not how it works. How is it done? It's by allowing the Holy Spirit to get down deep in our heart and change that which is necessary so that we are truly transformed. So who were we? We were dead. Who are we? We were raised. We are made alive. And then verse 8, continuing, it says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not the result of work, so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship." God's painting a picture. You are his masterpiece. You're his masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good. For good. You are created. You are not evolved. In the beginning, God created. Created in Christ Jesus for good. Now, I want you to sit in that for a minute, because not all of us believe that. You are, as a believer in Jesus Christ, a benefit to those around you. You are a blessing to those around you. Created in Christ Jesus for good. For good. That's what God does in us. For good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. At the beginning, right, we were walking how? According to the course of this world. But now, what do we have? Now we have a new walk, a new course, a new way. See, we are now walking on a different path, becoming God's masterpiece, which he prepared beforehand that we would walk in them. So, What's your ID? I was dead in my transgressions and sins, but I am now. I am alive together with Christ. I'm seated in the heavenly places. And who are you becoming? I am His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that I should walk in them. So if anybody asks you now, who are you? You have an answer. You have an answer. That's who you are. So there's a challenge before us today. As I conclude, there's a challenge. And the challenge is this. Will you covenant with yourself, with God, with others in the body to continue to walk on the path toward Christ-likeness? Not the path of religiousness. The path of Christ-likeness. That's the challenge. And what that means in simple terms is this, is I am going to create an atmosphere in my own heart where God can get at me. That's why we gather here. Do you know trials and tribulations and the stuff that happens to us? Do you know what they really are? They're like the idiot lights on your dashboard. They're indicators. They tell us something about us. How I deal with life, how I deal with circumstances, is an indicator of where I am in my path toward Christ. James said it this way. Count it all joy when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. But then he adds this, and let endurance have its perfect result. In other words, I could be walking through trials and tribulations, and instead of making me better, it can make me bitter. Ouch. Wow. See, nobody ever said, by the way, the path toward Christ-likeness is supposed to be easy. I hope you're not getting that from me. But it is full of joy. Now, I don't mean we're ecstatic every minute. The joy is that we are becoming who He desires for us to be. We're making forward progress. The book of Ecclesiastes says, everything's vanity. That's what this life is. This life is no progress. The laundry is never done. The grass is never cut. The house is never finished. There's always more to do. And it's this cycle of monotony over and over, but not in Christ. Not in Christ. We can actually see progress. I don't know about you, but that is a joy to me. If you can actually see forward motion, that's an exciting thing. So, let's take our steps. Take our steps. One more, one more, one more. And it's a strength-building thing because the Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength. Wow. So that's the challenge. Will you make a commitment? I determine by the grace of God to become more and more and more like Jesus. I will use every trial, tribulation, difficulty. I will use every emotional element that reveals something in me to let it be an indicator. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. I see you want to do something there. Does that make any sense to you at all? Right? So when your spouse offends you, what is that? That's an indicator. Now, my spouse never offends me. Why are you laughing? I certainly never offend her. It's an indicator. I think I gave this illustration last time. The problem in marriage is not so much that my wife can push my buttons. The problem is I have buttons to push. So, all of those indicators. So here's what I want you to do, is just make that commitment to say yes to Jesus. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me. Close your eyes. As your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, this is between you and the Lord. So I'm not even going to have anybody raise hands or anything like that today. Not going to do it. But in your heart, right there in your seat, with you and the Holy Spirit, I'm going to ask you to make the commitment to become more like Jesus. I know that's what we want. I know that's what we desire. And I know that's what we're trying to do. But we also know that we aren't always effective at it. So, Lord, I'm going to ask that those of us who are committed to become more like you, that, Lord, you reveal yourself to us. Because these things are spiritually discerned. You reveal yourself to us in greater measure that, Lord, we can continue to become more and more like you. Lord, we declare our love for you, knowing your great love for us. And we thank you for it. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Pastor.
Amen. What a good word. This morning, if any of you need prayer, we will be available to pray with you. We'd love to have the opportunity to do that. In the meanwhile, though, just remember to check those clipboards out before you leave. And we have a lot of different things coming up today in this coming week or so. But we love you all very much, and we're so glad that you're here, and let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Live it and walk it out. You know, we don't just come to church. We leave here as the church and go into the world as temples of the Holy Spirit, carrying with us the very presence and nature of God to a world that needs Jesus, who's wanting the very thing that you have gotten a taste of. So taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. God bless you all.